thank you very much, Alicia. Before I say anything, can I invite everyone to give a round of applause for Alicia and Laura for organizing this special thing. And it represents and reflects so well on their courage and commitment to these issues. So really, thank you so much. And it is the second time that we've been invited to this event. In fact, I don't know if I told you, Farrell & Co were the first serious people who backed us, even before we got charitable status. And that meant so much to us, and I think put us on such a firm footing for the whole of the rest of that year, knowing that people like yourselves were willing to back us at such an early stage. And I want to really thank you for that solidarity, which has been priceless throughout all our endeavours in that first year of operation. Let's have another round of applause. This kind of stuff, you know, we thrive on support. It really doesn't come enough. The Habeas Corpus Project is a very small law center which was founded in 2014 to provide pro bono representation to migrants and refugees held in detention. There are 30,000 migrants and refugees detained in the UK every single year. The decision to detain is not made by a judge, is not done with any due diligence, is not done with any court process. It happens in an office where an immigration officer looks at some papers and decides to take someone's liberty away. It's as simple as that. And it happens 30,000 times every year. The people that get detained are not criminals. They have not had lawyers represent them. They are being detained because of the color of their passport, but it's not our color. And we want to get rid of them. That's the reason they get detained. Indefinitely. Without any knowledge of when they're going to be released. The psychological anxiety of having that happen to you is overwhelming. Few people, I think, realize that this happens in the UK. In the 800th anniversary of the Magna Carta, which we celebrated last year, celebrating our great British heritage of rule of law and democracy, the Magna Carta itself saying no person shall be detained without being convicted before a jury of their peers, was totally ignored 30,000 times last year. 40% of those in immigration detention don't have lawyers. The other 60%, some of them have legal aid. A great number of them are having to fork out thousands of pounds to pay for legal representation, which in my experience falls far short of the representation they deserve. One of our High Court judges, Michael Fordham, QC, described immigration detention as the most pressing rule of law issue of our era. And I think that's an understatement. The people that end up in detention are victims of torture, victims of rape, victims of human trafficking, children, pregnant women, people suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder having been tortured, people who have no reason in law to be in detention, and yet they are, because there is a lack of access to justice, because of the lack of rule of law, because of our government's decision to cut legal aid, which puts people like us in a position where we have to pick up those pieces, and it is unremittingly depressing having to do that, but that is what we must do. Because of a lack of political willpower, these people suffer tremendously in our name. Last month, Her Majesty's Prisons Inspectorate wrote a report on the detention facilities at Dover, which is where the majority of those fleeing from places like Syria, Eritrea, and Yemen are arriving to the UK. The ones we see whose houses have been burnt, who are fleeing across the Mediterranean, who end up in places like the jungle in Calais, which is a horrible name, just to explore, and then survive an arduous journey through the channel, sometimes on the back of a lorry, children, huge amounts of them, to be welcomed in these conditions. They get put into a freight container where they sleep on concrete floors, where they are not given hot food or hot drinks, with no clothes being given to them, suffering from dehydration, diarrhea, and scabies, where toilet facilities are not provided, where blankets are provided but not washed, where children and women who just survived that journey are put into the same room as unrelated adult men. They are crowded, poorly ventilated, and smelling badly, says the prison's inspectorate of Her Majesty. Permission was required to take a shower in these places. The report concludes that this place is not fit for purpose, that it is wholly unacceptable. Thousands were put in those conditions last year. And only now, our Minister for Immigration accepts that that is not acceptable. Only after the accountability of this report, when a serious organisation such as Her Majesty's Prisons Inspectorate condemns it. Had that not happened, that situation would have continued, and I think accountability is key. The public do not want those conditions to continue, and when they know about them, they will be willing to protest against them. But accountability is key. It's not just the centres in Dover. It's Europe's biggest detention centre, which we hold near Heathrow Airport, Harmondsworth. Yarlswood Detention Centre, where females are kept, also described by Her Majesty's Prisons Inspectorate as a place of national concern, where we repeatedly come across detainees who are the victims of rape, who are trying to kill themselves in detention, who are heroin addicts, who have no representation. This is the state we're in, and very little is being done about that. It's not just the prison's inspectorate. The prison's ombudsman was commissioned by Theresa May herself to investigate in a 6-month inquiry into the conditions of detention. The prison's ombudsman published that report just a couple of weeks ago, called the Shaw Report. Says our government has been detaining victims of rape, people with learning difficulties, people suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder. There are instances of suicide and self-harm. Says most of those currently in detention do not represent any serious risk to the public. Many represent a very low risk to the public, and they have strong links to the UK. These are our institutions which are condemning what Theresa May and the governments before her are continuing to do, and continue to do at a faster rate, at a greater scale. What do we do, the Habeas Corpus Project? I've been practicing as a barrister for 5 years. I started doing this work because I was constantly coming across people who were desperate, who had no one else. And it was clear to me that they should not be in detention. It was clear to me that a decision had been made unlawfully. And I ended up helping. I mean, most reasonable people do when they have the knowledge, which I did have, to help. I was doing it so frequently that I decided why not start a movement. And we did that. How will we survive? Farah and Co. were the first people to lend their solidarity and support. I never anticipated such support. And I can say, without a doubt, had it not been for that solidarity, we would have crumbled. Had it not been for the will and the encouragement and the support, tens of volunteers who've seen what we're doing and believed in us. It's been an incredibly difficult first 1.5 years. In our first year, our staff worked without remuneration. We worked for free for the whole first 12 months. We represented 100 detainees. It takes an emotional toll on those who work in this field. We've come to realise that whilst the support that we've been receiving, emotional support, has been the reason we still exist, we cannot continue without some funding. It's simply impossible. This is not the job for one person, or even a job for two people. It's a job for hundreds of people, and even the work that we've done represents a minuscule amount compared to the tens of thousands who need help. We ultimately need money to pay for office infrastructure. We'd like to pay a minimum wage to the people who work for us. We can't agree with that. We have expenses in order to survive, and I would ask those who have those positions to kindly donate. I can assure you that it goes to a good cause. And even if you can't, to lend the same emotional support, because that does mean a lot to us, whether it's by volunteerism, whether it's by putting us in touch with people who you think can help us, or by highlighting those issues in your private lives with your family and your friends, because it is a political issue which we need momentum for to change. So, I want to raise a toast, which I have to raise my microphone for, and then not my last, to the kindness and generosity of Alicia and Laura, to the kindness and generosity of those who have supported us, and to all those in the pro bono sector, who had to hear another speech from a lady who does similar things, who continue to fight and we'll never give up on that course. Cheers to you all. Thank you.